बहुत-बहुत स्वागत है आपका सक्सेस मंच चैनल पर। दोस्तों, आज फिर हम हाज़िर हो गए हैं ऑडियो सीरीज़ का नेक्स्ट पार्ट लेकर, जिसमें कि हम चैप्टर 4 शुरू करेंगे। तो चैप्टर 3 तक आप सुन सकते हैं हमारे चैनल सक्सेस मंच पर। और ये सीरीज़ है, ऑडियो सीरीज़ आपको बता दूँ, ओल्ड NCERT की, जो कि एंशंट हिस्ट्री है क्लास 11th की। तो आपको हिंदी में भी अगर ये सीरीज़ चाहिए, ये क्योंकि इंग्लिश में है, तो आप हमें प्लीज़ कमेंट कीजिए, हम आपके लिए लेकर आएंगे। तो चलिए शुरू करते हैं चैप्टर 4, द ज्योग्राफिकल बैकग्राउंड ऑफ इंडियन हिस्ट्री। इंडियन सबकॉन्टिनेंट इज़ अ वेल डिफाइंड लैंड विद नेचुरल बॉर्डर्स। एट प्रेजेंट देर आर 6 कंट्रीज इन दिस एरिया: अफगानिस्तान, पाकिस्तान, नेपाल, इंडिया, भूटान एंड बांग्लादेश। इन एंशंट टाइम्स दिस होल मास ऑफ लैंड वॉज नोन एज भारत वर्ष और हिंदुस्तान। द लेटर इज़ डिराइव्ड फ्रॉम द नेम ऑफ द रिवर सिंधु, प्रोनाउंस्ड बाय द वेस्टर्नर्स एज हिंदू और इंदू। इंडिया गेट्स इट्स डेरिवेशन फ्रॉम दिस। इन आर कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन इट इज कॉल्ड इंडिया, दिस इज भारता। This land is bordered in the north by the Himalayas, the western and northwestern side by Pamir Plateau and Sulaimar Kirthar ranges, on the eastern side by the Bay of Bengal and western side by the Arabian Sea. Southern borders are bounded by Indian Ocean. Physically, the subcontinent can be studied in three parts: the Himalayas, the Indo-Gangetic Brahmaputra Plain, the Deccan Plateau. Now we'll start with the Himalayas. The Himalayas are stretched from Afghanistan in the west up to Myanmar in the east. The Tibetan Plateau forms the northern part of it. It is more than 2400 kilometers long and about 250 to 320 kilometers wide. There are about 114 peaks, which are more than 20,000 feet high. Some of the highest peaks are Gauri Shankar or Everest, the highest mountain in the world, Kanchenjunga, Dholagiri, Nanga Parvat and Nanda Devi. The Hindu Kush mountains, right from the Pamir, form the natural western boundaries of the Indian subcontinent. The mountains or Safed Koh, Sulaiman and Kirtham separate Iran from the Indian subcontinent, but the large stretches of land to the west of this line in modern Afghanistan and Balochistan, like those to the south and east of the Hindu Kush, were for long both culturally and politically parts of India. On the eastern side are the Patkui Hills, Naga Hills and Manipur Plateau, including the Khasi, Garo and Jaintia Hills. The Lushai and Chin Hills are to the south of Manipur. The Himalayas form a formidable barrier against the foreign invasions from the north, but it is not altogether secluded from the rest of the world. There are some important passes through which interaction with Western, Central and Northern Asia has been maintained since time immemorial. It is said that since early Shivalic times, there has been a more or less constant intercourse between East Africa, Arabia, Central Asia and India, maintained by migrations of herds of mammals. It is also stated that India received large accessions by migrations of the larger quadrupeds from Egypt, Arabia, Central Asia, and even from the distant North America by way of land bridges across Alaska, Siberia, and Mongolia. Human migration is also possible on these routes. In historical times, the use of Khyber and Bolan passes in the west is well known. Among these, the use of the former was very frequent and is known as the Gateway of India. Besides guarding the northern frontier of India from human invasions, the Himalayas protect us from the cold Siberian winds. The Great Indus, Ganga and Brahmaputra plains with most fertile land, natural resources and perennial rivers is a gift of the Himalayas for which Indians gratefully worship it as God. Indo-Gangetic Brahmaputra plain. To the south of the Himalayas lies the Great Plain of India, which is more than 3200 kilometers long and about 240 kilometers to 320 kilometers broad. It is formed by the solid waste of the Himalayas brought by hundreds of descending streams. The alluvium thus formed made the plains most fertile. There are three great river systems originating from the Himalayas which supply perennial waters to this great plain. These are the Indus, the Ganga and the Brahmaputra. But a big tract of the land to the west of Yamuna and east of Indus is in this plain is devoid of any water system at present. This tract includes the states of Haryana, Punjab and Rajasthan. Now it has been proved that in ancient times the river Saraswati and its tributaries used to flow in this area. The Sindhu or Indus rises from the Kailasha Mansarovar area in the Tibetan Plateau, runs west and northwest for about 1300 kilometers between the Karakoram range. They joined by the Gilgit River, it turns south and reached the plains where the five rivers join it from Panchananda Desh or Punjab. These five tributaries of the Sindhu from east to west are the Satluj, Sadundri, the Bis, Bipasa, the Ravi, Parushni, and the Chenab, Asikni, and the Jhelum, Vitesta. The first mentioned river, Satluj or Satundri, was once a tributary of the lost river Saraswati, but changed its course. The Ganga, rising from the Himalayas, reaches the plain at Haridwar and passes through the states of Uttarakhand, Uttar Pradesh, Bihar and Bengal, then join the Bay of Bengal. On the west of it flows the river Yamuna, also rising from the Himalayas. Some of India's rivers like the Chambal, the Betwa, the Ken join the Yamuna before the confluence with the Ganga at Allahabad. Another great Vindhyan river, the Son, joins the Ganga near Patna in Bihar. From the Himalaya side, rivers like the Gomti, the Saryu, the Gandak and the Kosi join the Ganga in the states of Uttar Pradesh and Bihar. There are several mouths through which the Ganga falls into the Bay of Bengal. The main stream is called Bhagirathi or Hooghly, on which are situated the towns of Murshidabad, Hooghly and Kolkata. The easternmost mouth of the Ganga is called the Padma. The great Brahmaputra, originating from the eastern part of the lake Mansarovar in the Kailasha, flows eastward through the plateau of Tibet under the name of Tsangpo. Then it turns south and enters in India where it assumes the name Dehang. Later, the river Dehang and Luhit join and are called Brahmaputra or Lohitya. Passing through Assam and Bengal, it joins the easternmost mouth of the Ganga, that is Padma, but before falling into the Bay of Bengal, another mighty river, the Meghna, joins it. The delta thus formed is one of the most fertile part of Bengal and is known as Sundarban Delta. The Deccan Plateau and Central India. Peninsular India can be studied under two distinct sections, the mountain ranges of the Vindhyas and Satpura run parallel to each other from east to west. In between these two flows the river Narmada going towards the Arabian Sea. The only other river flowing towards west is Tapti, lying a little south of the Satpura. All other rivers of the peninsula run from west to east, falling into the Bay of Bengal, indicating that the plateau is tilted towards east. The northern portion of the plateau, separated by the Vindhya-Satpura ranges, is known as the Central Indian Plateau, while the southern portion is called the Deccan Plateau. Now, Central Indian Plateau. The Central Indian Plateau stretches from the Gujarat to the west to Chota Nagpur in the east. The Great Indian Desert called Thar lies to the north of the Aravali Range. To the south of it is the Vindhyas, which rises abruptly from the Narmada side, that is south, and has a slopy formation in the south. The Malwa Plateau and the tablelands of Bundelkhand and Bagelkhand are part of it. As a result, all the rivers on this side flow towards north or northeast to join the Yamuna and the Ganga. The eastern stretches of the Vindhyas, known as the Kaimur Ranges, extend almost up to the south of Banaras and run parallel with Ganga up to the Rajmahal Hills. Between the Ganga and the Rajmahal is a narrow defile or a passage from Chunar in the west, that is Mirzapur, UP, to Telyagadi in the east. This is the only high road which connects western and eastern India. Its strategic importance from the military point of view was fully understood, which is evident by the presence of hill forts of Rohtas and Chunar in the east and Kalijar and Gwalior in the west. It is said that the passes of Shahabad and Telyagadi, situated at a distance of only about 5 kilometers from each other, served as the gateway to Bengal. On the western side of the plateau and the Thar Desert is situated the rich lowland of Gujarat, having several low hills and watered by the number of rivers like Mahi, Sabarmati and lower courses of Narmada and Tapti. The Kathiawar Peninsula and the Run of Kutch are marshy and dry during the hot season. Now, the Deccan Plateau. As we have noted earlier, the surface of the Deccan Plateau slopes down from west to east. On the western side lies a range of high cliffs running south to north, leaving a narrow strip of plain between it and the sea. It is called the Western Ghats, which rises up to 3,000 feet. The plateau is higher in the south, being about 2,000 feet in the Mysore region and about half of that in the Hyderabad. The eastern ghats, consisting of groups of low hills, is marked by several gaps through which many peninsular rivers join the Bay of Bengal. The hills going southwards, gradually receding from the sea, turn westward to join the western ghat at the Nilgiri. The plain between Eastern Ghat and the sea is wider than that of Western Ghats. Except the Narmada and the Tapti, which run towards west and join the Arabian Sea, all the rivers of the peninsula India run from west to east. Most of them rise from the Western Ghat and, traversing the whole breadth of the plateau, fall in the bay. The Mahanadi forms a broad plain known as the Chhattisgarh Plain in the northeast. It passes through Orissa before joining the sea. The valley of Godavari with its tributary has a large flat land in the north, but it narrows in the east before meeting the sea. Further south, the Krishna with its tributary, like the Tungabhadra, divide the Deccan Plateau into two sections. Further south, the Kaveri and its tributaries form another important river system. One thing should be mentioned here, that these rivers are different from those of the North India. Devoid of a perennial water source like the Himalayas, these southern rivers are mostly dry during the hot season, hence less valuable for irrigation and navigation purposes. Now the coastal regions. The fertile coastal plains are important because they also provide opportunities for maritime activities and trade. The western coastal plain stretches from the Gulf of Cambay in the north to Kerala in south. The northern part is called the Konkan, while the southern part is called Malabar coast. The rainfall in this region is very high. There are no big rivers, but smaller rivers provide easy communication and irrigation. There are some good harbors in the Konkan region and also in the Malabar. On the other hand, the eastern coast has a few natural harbors, but during the historical period, maritime activities led to more vigorous and fruitful contacts with the Southeast Asian countries. The southern tip of the peninsula is known as Cape Camarin or Kanyakumari. To its southeast is the island of Sri Lanka, which though not an integral part, has been closely associated with India. As almost continuous chain of islands and shoals connect India with this island, which has been given the name of Adam's Bridge. The mango-shaped island was known in ancient times by the name of Tambapurni, a corrupt word from Sanskrit Tambrapani, that is having a look or shape of Tambula or betel leaf. It was also known as Simhaladweepa. So, अगले session में हम climate से बात करेंगे chapter 4 का, तो second part का आप इंतज़ार कीजिए. तब तक के लिए आप सभी का धन्यवाद और बने रहिए हमारे channel के साथ. अगर आपको कोई comment करना है तो हमें comment section में please बताइए कि हम क्या और सुधार कर सकते हैं, और आपको कुछ special series चाहिए तो उसके लिए भी आप हमें बता सकते हैं. तो thank you so much for being with us. Thank you.